Imagine this scenario. You're at the gym in the middle of a hard set of bench press, and you have two choices. Number one, do as many reps as you can and have your friend help you complete the last rep. Number two, stop one or two reps before failure and do an extra set with the same weights. Which choice is better for muscle and strength gains?
Surprisingly, the second option.
What? But the posters in my gym said to go hard or go home. Unless I puke, faint or die, I should keep going.
Well, there's some truth to that.
In research, when volume and intensity are matched, training to failure is superior for both strength and muscle growth. For example, in a 2005 study by Drinkwater and colleagues, two groups of young novice athletes were assigned a volume of 24 reps on the bench press with their 6RM. 6RM means a weight that they could lift for a maximum of 6 reps. Group A did those 24 reps in 4 sets of 6, taking every set to failure. Group B did those 24 reps in 8 sets of 3. They used the same weight as the first group, but stopped 3 reps before failure in every set. After 6 weeks, Group A increased strength by an average of 7.3 kg, while Group B only by 3.6 kg.
I knew it.
The posters are right. Go hard or go home.
Yes, when volume and intensity are fixed, training to failure is superior. The reason for that is because by training to failure, you inevitably end up doing more effective reps than someone not training to failure with the same volume. This is what happened in the study. The closer the reps are to failure, the more strongly they stimulate adaptation. The last few reps of that 6RM set were the most effective. Of course, the group that did only the first 3 reps didn't grow much, even if they did the same 24 reps. They probably barely broke a sweat. On the other hand, the group that trained to failure got a much better training stimulus.
But what if volume and intensity are not fixed? Well, in that case, stopping one or two reps shy of failure each set becomes superior, because you can do more total effective reps in a workout. Let's see why.
The current research on muscle growth shows us a few things. Number one, hypertrophy tends to increase with the number of sets performed. However, there are diminishing returns. After a certain point, called maximum recoverable volume, each increase actually has a negative effect. This was shown in a study by Gonzalez Badillo, where 3 groups of weightlifters were put on different amounts of volume for 10 weeks. The first group did 1923 reps, the second group did 2481 reps, and the third group did 3030 reps. All groups progressed in strength, but the second group progressed the most. This suggests that progress has a linear relationship with volume, but only up to a point. After that point, training more makes you go backwards. The second thing research shows us is that there is an intensity threshold that we have to pass in order for reps to become effective. In other words, not all volume is equal. It needs to be heavy. For example, a study by Brad Schoenfeld compared muscle and strength gains between two groups. A group that trained with light loads and did 25-35 reps per set, and a high load group that did 8-12 reps per set. Both groups gained the same amount of muscle, but it was much harder for the light load group. The guys were lifting baby weights for 30 reps, but the first 20 were basically a warm-up, too light to do anything. Only the last few reps, which were actually hard to do, induced muscle growth. And the third thing research shows us is that it's better to spread your volume over multiple workouts instead of doing everything in one session. Rasted and colleagues found this studying the Norwegian powerlifting team. The powerlifters did the same amount of volume and intensity, but with different frequencies. Half the team trained 3 times a week, and the other half split each workout in 2 and trained 6 times per week. Strength and muscle gains were found to be better in the higher frequency group, despite doing the exact same amount of work.
And what does this have to do with training to failure?
Well, training to failure negatively affects all these factors. First of all, it reduces the amount of effective reps you can do in a workout. For example, let's say that you do 3 sets with a load you can lift 10 times, your 10RM. If you go to failure in the first set, you will be very fatigued in your second set and probably only be able to do 7 reps with the same weight. If you go to failure again, in your third set, you'll be able to do only about 5 reps. So in total, you get 22 reps that have the potential to stimulate growth. But if you stop at 9 reps in your first set, you will be able to do 9 reps again in your second set. Then in your third set, you'll probably be able to do 8 reps. So in total, you get 26 reps that have the potential to stimulate growth.
Yeah, but aren't those less effective reps?
Probably, but only by a small amount, because you're stopping just one rep shy of failure.
Considering that hypertrophy goes hand in hand with the amount of effective volume you do, you will grow better that way. Not only that, but if you wanted to, you could add a fourth set to that exercise. This will increase the training stimulus even further. Another big disadvantage of training to failure is that it puts more stress on your body, requiring a longer recovery time between workouts. Because of that, the training frequency that you can use is reduced. For example, you may have an upper body workout on Monday and another upper body workout on Thursday. Training to failure on the first session will suppress force production for the second workout. This will negatively affect both the number of reps you can do and how heavy you can train. And yet another disadvantage is that you will accumulate residual fatigue faster, making you have to deload more often. So, instead of cranking out reps to failure until the sheer intensity makes you blow out a booger,
ugh, come on, man!
It's better to leave 1-2 reps in the tank at the end of your sets with all compound exercises. Hey, it's Radu here, thanks for watching my video. Most of the information I shared here comes from Eric Helms, who is studying autoregulation for his PhD. I love that guy. I highly recommend his work. To help you set up your training and nutrition for your goal physique, I put together a free fitness course called The Path to Your Goal Physique. Click on it to get it for free. To check out the program I'm currently using, click on ShredSmart. Also, for more videos like this one, make sure that you subscribe.
Să zărim muții!